claims he is the tallest copywriter in the world, and he works at Geometry Global in Chicago. Geometry is WPP's end-to-end creative commerce agency, where they claim they create engaging new commerce experiences to unlock commercial growth. 10 months into his job at the creative commerce agency, David talks about his passion for creative concepting, group collaboration, and he's currently sketching ideas for the 2021 Cannes Creativity Awards. David is an extraordinary guest that provides great insight on the determination it takes to break into the copywriting world. And his main tip, which we talk about in this episode, is to find and listen to the critical people when developing your book as early as possible. So whether you're a student, recent grad, or just about to hang up your hat in advertising, I'm here solely to share advertisers' break-in stories so we can educate and inspire those younger than us. And if you find anything useful, share it with somebody younger than you that wants to break in, or give it 5 stars, or follow us on Instagram at EnteringEd. This is the Breaking and Entering Podcast, and as usual, I am your accomplice, Gino Schellenberg. David Hood, how are you today?
Living the dream. Obviously, we're still working from home here, but making the best of it, making the best of the situation. So happy to be here. Happy to be on your podcast finally.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming on. I'm really excited about this episode. To my knowledge, you are the copywriter at Geometry, which is a creative commerce agency under WPP. And that's what we're going to dive into today. And I'm super excited to hear how you broke in on the copywriting side, which we all know isn't the easiest task in the world.
Yeah, there's definitely some hurdles you have to jump. But once you're in, it can be a lot of fun and pretty rewarding.
So why copywriting? Were you an English major? What made you go into copywriting?
Well, I always knew that I wanted to do something creative. And back in high school, even, I was thinking about jobs like in engineering or in car design. And then I started doing really poorly in a lot of math classes. So those paths started to close. Then in, I guess it was my sophomore or junior year of high school, I came across advertising as a career and came across Illinois as the school I wanted to go to, with the proximity to Chicago and the good rankings that the advertising program had there. So one thing led to another, worked on my portfolio all through college, and started off at a different agency for a summer internship, and then moved to Geometry last August. So I've been there now, it's June now, so almost, I guess, 10 months now. So
congratulations.
Thank you.
With that story, which I want to pick apart a little bit, did you say that you went into college knowing you wanted to do advertising, or did you stumble upon it once you got there? How did that work?
I went into college knowing I wanted to do advertising.
How? That's almost unheard of for most students going directly into advertising, because 2/3 of the department at University of Illinois transfer in. So you were part of that third that knew directly. Yeah. So how did you have somebody that you knew tell you about it when you were younger, or did you just do your research? How did you stumble upon that?
I legitimately believe it was a Google search, just a Google search for creative careers. And nice. Came across advertising.
Nice. And then did you look at any ad agencies, or did you know, did you have a path sketched out at that point, or just like, all right, this is it. I want to be creative. This sounds awesome.
Yeah. I knew back in high school that I had an idea of how I wanted to get in. Researching a lot of agencies in Chicago, obviously big ones like Leo Burnett and FCB,
of course,
and DDB. But I actually, to make it work so that I could go to Illinois, have that proximity to Chicago and the ad program, I moved my senior year of high school to Illinois. I grew up in Missouri, in a town called St. Charles, about 25 miles northwest of St. Louis.
Okay.
Moved to O'Fallon, Illinois my senior year of high school. Got an apartment, transferred schools to O'Fallon High School, and moved my job out there so I could pay the rent on my apartment. And doing that allowed me to get in-state tuition at Illinois and eventually be able to break into the industry after building a portfolio during my time in college.
So you knew you wanted to go to the University of Illinois. You lived
yes,
25 miles south of St. Louis, and you told your parents, I'm going to University of Illinois, and to do this, I need to move.
Yep, pretty much.
Insane. And did they move with you, or did you just go on your own? How does that work?
So my dad worked in South St. Louis County. He works for Panera Bread. And our house is 30 minutes away from where he worked. My apartment in Illinois was also 30 minutes away from where he worked. So my dad would come every other night to check on me, basically.
Okay.
So I lived with my dad part-time during that.
Wow. Year. Wow. How, I mean, and then you finish your senior year in Illinois.
Yes.
You got the how was that experience? Were you able to keep on top of your grades? I mean, did you mess around at all?
Yeah, I think it definitely made me really independent, which is something I really appreciate now, and helped build my work ethic too, because
sure. I had
7 or 8 hours of school and then another 5 hours of work after school and then homework. So I was putting in pretty consistently 12-hour days, and
wow.
I think that helped me as I broke into the industry, being willing to put in the effort and put in the work necessary to make it happen.
So yeah, I mean,
I'm grateful for that.
100%. That work ethic, I could not imagine being a senior, 18 years old, on my own, part time, if you will. You know, just putting in all those hours of work every day. It's hard to stay on track at that age. So kudos to you. Wow. But my question is why? Like, why did you, like, Illinois, great, great advertising program, of course. But Mizzou, one of the best journalism programs. I'm just curious to, like, what was that deciding force?
My parents actually went to Mizzou and were pushing for it pretty heavily, but Mizzou's program was not as specific as Illinois' was. And, you know, being the J school is great, but
yeah,
I would have spent 2 years in a lot of journalism classes that I didn't feel very directly related as much to advertising as the curriculum at Illinois. Now, I was also just drawn to the campus and the proximity to Chicago in general, because I knew I wanted to be working in Chicago after I graduated. So
Chicago,
Mizzou doesn't have quite the alumni base or the geographic proximity, just frankly, compared to Illinois. So those
both
were the
great schools. Yeah. Both are great schools. And I just had to figure that out for my own interests. But going back to advertising, you get to University of Illinois. Like, what are you doing to set yourself apart as a copywriter? And you came into school knowing that you wanted to be a copywriter pretty early, you would say?
Yeah, I came in wanting to be a creative. I didn't know whether that would be a copywriter or an art director initially, but
sure. Yeah.
I was drawn to the how fun it can be to conceptualize in copywriting. So I ultimately decided on that. My first year, I was really trying to, obviously the curriculum starts with Steve Hall's intro class and then goes through the different disciplines, but I wanted to get a head start on the creative since I knew that was what I wanted to end up doing. So beginning freshman year, I was starting to network with creative directors and also visit Peter Sheldon and Shahar with god awful, crap, terrible work.
As a freshman though.
As a freshman.
That's admirable if you're going there networking as a freshman.
Yeah, I just felt compelled to get a head start on that for some reason, and I find it fun. So that's something.
What's fun?
conceptualizing and copywriting in general. Gotcha. When you're coming up with really cool work, it's something
I thought you meant networking, and I don't find it very fun.
Yeah, it's something of a necessary evil, because I had Peter and Shahar available to critique my work and give advice and give me books to read, which I'm super grateful for that. But it was also helpful to get a lot of other perspectives on it, because probably the most frustrating thing when you're a student is getting, at least it was for me, was getting opposite feedback. So you'd have one creative director who loved your work and then another who would rip it apart.
Sure.
So you're kind of at a loss for what to do. And I think for me, the most helpful thing was to actually listen, especially so early on as a student, was to listen to the most critical voices. And I don't think maybe one of the campaigns I had come up with freshman year made it into the final book I used when I was applying to jobs. But wow. Listening to those critical voices really helped me hone my skills and get an idea of what was considered good work.
Yeah. So listening to the critical voices.
Right.
Exactly. And then, so you mentioned two of the top professors in our advertising department. But so who were some of those critical voices for you outside of the educator system?
Yeah. I actually met a creative director at Geometry. He was at Leo Burnett at the time.
Okay.
Who I met him freshman year, and
that's insane.
Every time I'd go into work with Peter and Shahar, I would send work to him too. So getting that voice really early on was super helpful. And other times it was just cold calling. LinkedIn has a really cool element called the alumni search tool. So I'd look for Illinois grads who are already in the industry, already doing creative, just ask them to review my book, send them a cold email or a cold message on LinkedIn. So I remember I talked to a copywriter at McGarry Bowen, a creative director at DDB who was one of Peter's first students.
Wow.
I tried to use the Illinois alumni network to my advantage to try to get feedback on my work and make it better.
And you started that very early. And I think,
yeah, I did.
And I think your story is definitely different from most advertising students.
Yeah.
You and I are pretty similar, that we both knew in high school that we wanted to be in advertising, and that makes life so much easier, David, wouldn't you agree?
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Cause then you could do your research. You know that if you're creative, you know you need to get started on your book as early as possible, no matter how bad it is in the beginning. But you're going to develop those skills, and you know, the networking. It makes life easier when you know you want to do advertising. And that's why I like this podcast. And I hope that it can go out to students that are in college, to recent graduates, but even like 18-year-olds in high school or whatever,
right,
juniors and seniors in high school, because if they understand the career path at that early of an age, then they can reverse engineer.
Exactly.
And that's what I did. I knew I wanted to be some sort of an account role as a freshman or even a senior in high school. And I reverse engineered it. I just thought about, this is how I get there, and this is what I need to do each year before that. And I just kind of tracked it back to freshman year. And I followed that path.
Yeah, exactly. I think we hear as high schoolers a lot of messages from high school counselors saying things like, you're going to college to figure out what you want to do. But yeah. I think if you really want to get a head start, figure out what you want to do even earlier. And it's okay if it doesn't work out. But if you do figure that out at an earlier age, you have a head start on everyone else who didn't.
Yeah.
So that can be really advantageous to you. And I think it was helpful to me in my experience too.
Yeah, I think you're going to experience moments of doubt when you're in college.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I've seen plenty of my friends switch majors two to even three times throughout the course of their career, their college career. And it just kind of sets them farther back. They work harder to catch up. And, you know, if you're not happy with where you're at, of course, you have to explore other options. But There's nothing like, you know, diving headfirst into something that you're passionate about. And hopefully our conversation today can influence that upon people that are younger and they can dive into advertising.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm not saying, like, if you're miserable in your major, don't change your major. I'm just saying, if you're younger, figuring out what your passion is earlier can be really helpful. If you're miserable, do everything you can to make yourself not miserable. But
of course,
just seeing that early start, it can be really, really helpful to you and to other people trying to break into the industry too.
Another thing I love about advertising as a major is the coursework. The coursework is not grueling, I'll say.
Right.
And, you know, compared to those of the engineering discipline, you're not sitting at a book solving problems for a couple hours a night. You're not doing math problems. You're not writing super long, like 10-page thesis papers, which gives you free time. And then that makes it, the challenge is to use your free time in a way that can better your positioning as an advertising student. So what did you do with your free time as an advertising student at University of Illinois?
Well, freshman year, I initially just started off, I wanted to get right into making ads. And I actually believe that was a mistake in the early stages. I should have read several books first, I think, before actually getting started trying to make spec work. Those were Hey Whipple, Squeeze This by Luke Sullivan, the Advertising Concept book, How to Put a Book Together and Get a Job in Advertising by Maxine Petro, and then just using the communications library's resources. So I remember one summer I stayed in Champaign, and every morning at 9:30, I would go to the communications library and just park myself with about 3 1 show awards annuals. And I'd take pictures of the work that I thought was the most impressive. And I'd store a file of that on my computer. And I'd learn what made that work so good. And I could apply the strategies that they use to make that work at that level to my own spec book. So definitely using the resources and expertise of not only Peter and Shahar, but of other people who have made it into the industry and made really great work can be really helpful.
Amazing that you mentioned. I love that you mentioned the communications library and that you just go there. I'm a firm believer that schools and universities in any department should make it very clear the resources they have for all their students throughout their time there. I didn't realize all the stuff that we had, like the LinkedIn Learning was available for us for 4 years. I figured that out my junior year. Just the resources and database we have access to Ad Age, I believe, at the University of Illinois. Go to your website, students out there, go to the, you know, your department's website, the library website, and click resources, explore those, because you have no clue the amount of memberships that they waive because you're a student. You pay a lot of money for school, right, David?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh God. Yeah.
So you'd be foolish not to at least look at what you have. So, and as well, a quick tip, wearenext.com. Everybody knows We Are Next. I don't have to talk much about it. They have an index portion on their website. There's a tab called Index, and it's a grid, and it gives you just the most insane resources about, you know, if you want to do creative, they have strategy breakdowns, creative briefs that you can look at. Definitely check that out as a student. So I'm glad that you mentioned that.
Yeah, use your tuition to the fullest. You're paying for it. Might as well.
Paying a lot for it.
Exactly.
So you're recommending that students don't just go making ads out of nowhere right away. Get educated, read up, read how to do it the right way, and then go dive in.
Yeah, I think that was one of the mistakes I made early on, was not having a reference of what good work looked like and what strategies they use to get it to that level. So did you ever, absolutely.
Did you ever take a advertising history class or
I did. Yeah, I took, I think it was 311 with Jason Chambers. I took that my freshman year too.
real? I regret not taking it. I
Yeah, it
never
was a
took
good
that
class.
class and I wish I could take it. I feel like I'm my personal background in advertising is a little off because I don't have that strong foundation.
Oh yeah, I think that class, and it's a 300 level class that you can take your freshman year too. So I definitely learned, some of the ads they went over were from the 20s, and the super lengthy copy that was fashionable then is not exactly fashionable now, but you get a baseline for what to expect and where the industry has been. And I think that can be really helpful.
Amazing. So tell me more about copywriting in itself. What is it like today at your agency at Geometry? What are your daily tasks? What do you love? What do you hate? Just give me the rundown.
Well, this is going to sound really cliche, but every day can be pretty different. I guess
I've
they're a
heard
little
that
more
before.
similar now that every day is at home, but
Yeah.
the assignments are different. The creativity level of each assignment can be different. So, for example, right now we're starting an initiative to come up with ideas for Cannes, which is the leading awards show in the industry, right?
Are they still doing that this year?
No, it got canceled. We're actually trying to plan for 2021. So
Wow.
that's been a lot of fun because it's felt like you get the freedom that I had when I was putting my book together, right? You don't have brand guidelines that you have to reference necessarily. You don't have client feedback. You're just trying to come up with the coolest idea that could work for the brand that would drive sales, but also just wow the rest of the creative community, right? But you don't get to do the sexy stuff all the time necessarily. You have to help the agency keep the lights on, right? So
Right.
you have your day-to-day emails, digital ads, those types of things, but that's what makes sure that everyone's keeping their job, right? And keeping the clients
Absolutely.
happy. So it's about finding a balance with that. And
What's
oh, go ahead.
the hierarchy of copywriting like in your agency? Where are you
Well,
at? And then where is your boss at? Where's your boss's boss at?
sure. So, especially at the creative director level, things can change a lot agency to agency. But I'm obviously not at the creative director level. I started as an intern, so I'd say that's where you start off. You're a copywriter intern. Then generally, you become a junior copywriter. The agency I was at over the summer called their juniors associate copywriters. So there's a little bit of difference in terminology, but it's
Okay.
effectively the same role. Then from junior copywriter, you can move to mid-level copywriter, just drop in the junior tag. And then after mid-level copywriter, you become a senior copywriter. After senior copywriter, you become an associate creative director. So you may still have a copy focus, but you're also reviewing others' work that you may be reviewing a copywriter and an art director's work at that level. And then from there, the sky's the limit. So you can have a vice president creative director,
Sure.
group creative director, executive creative director, chief creative officer. So at the agency I was last at, my boss's boss was an executive creative director, and my boss was an ACD.
Got
And
it.
at Geometry, my boss is an ACD, and my boss's boss is a group creative director. They're mostly the same roles with different titles based on
Amazing.
the agency.
And I'm assuming you're going for as high up as possible, as fast as possible.
I'm not sure. I like the ability to concept, and I think you lose some of that the higher you go. You become an arbiter of concepts as opposed to a concept, someone who actually creates the concepts. So that's the part of the job that brings me the most joy.
Yeah,
And
at this part of your life, yeah.
at this part of my life. Now,
Yeah.
that's not to say later in life that won't change, but
Absolutely.
right now, I just want to come up with cool shit.
Yeah. And that's so cool that you're able to do that. 10 months in, and you're concepting and you're doing great things, it sounds like.
We're trying.
Yeah. Yep. So tell me about geometry itself. And another cool part about this podcast, or at least I hope, is that we're not only educating students and recent grads on different roles and different people and networking, but we're also teaching people about different ad agencies. So what makes geometry different? What do you love about it? What gets you up and excited to work every day?
Well, I think it's the possibility to come up with really great ideas. And we have these monthly sessions with our chief creative officer, and actually he may be a North America executive creative director. I think that's his official title, where we just present all these really cool ideas to him. We also just recently moved to a new office in the West Loop next to Google.
Cool.
There all of 3 weeks, but it was cool while we were there.
You'll be back.
Yeah, we will, before the coronavirus shutdowns happened.
Yeah.
But you can see the entire Chicago skyline from the east-facing side of the building. And
nice.
That's a really cool sight. Also, a rec room on the sixth floor. You play pool, get some snacks. It's a cool space. We're right next to Google. A lot of cool restaurants in the West Loop. Expensive restaurants, though.
West Loop has the best food in Chicago.
Yeah. Yeah, we're right next to Time Out, too. Time Out's really, really cool. We've gone there for happy hours a few times.
So it sounds like it's conducive for a creative environment. You got the rec room. You got the cool West Loop vibe of good food and going out. And you got, and is it really that necessary as a creative? Is that something that drew you into the agency, or is it just like it's a good bonus on the side? Like, we're creative and we have fun.
I like having it. I think the focus for anyone trying to break in should be going where they feel they can do the most creative work.
Gotcha. And that, and this was the case for you.
That was the case for me. That's what brought me to geometry.
Nice.
So yeah, they're fun perks, but really it's all about the work you create and the work you do. So go where you think you'll have the best chance of doing that.
Nice. Now I want to talk about what do you do to thrive in your role as a copywriter at Geometry? So how many other copywriters are there, and what are you doing to set yourself apart?
I think especially at my level where I'm just starting out, I want to be proactive. So I like to go around and find extra projects or pitches to work on. It's also being proactive with our CAN sessions, right? So trying to come in with 4 or 5 ideas instead of 1 or 2, because ultimately sessions like that are a numbers game.
Yeah.
Some ideas will be killed by higher level creatives. Sometimes you'll make it all the way through, get the thumbs up from your boss's boss, and the client will kill it, or it'll be impractical, or production would be too complicated, so you have to shelve it. So it's really a numbers game. You just got to come in with a lot of ideas, an onslaught of ideas, to make it through.
Yeah, so being proactive is huge.
Yes, absolutely.
That can also mean identifying problems before they come, kind of like the environmental scanning aspect of the job.
Oh, yeah, definitely. So on the day-to-day stuff, it's a lot of referencing the style guides that the brands have and making sure that all the creative aligns to those style guides. So, and being proactive about doing that as well. So yeah, definitely.
Awesome. All right. I want to talk about, you mentioned it before that you had about 3 weeks in your new office.
Yeah.
And then the pandemic hit, COVID-19 struck, and you guys are forced to work at home. Has that transition been tough for you as a copywriter? Because at first you were at the West Loop, where you had that great view, you had the rec room, and now you're at home. Have you noticed a lack or less creativity because of it?
I think it's harder to brainstorm with other creatives. But there are other aspects of the job that I didn't realize would be as easy to do from home as they are. And it's really nice to actually spare the commute of going in and out of the office. Sometimes, depending on whether or not the CTA is on the ball, it could be 45 minutes to an hour to get in.
Yeah.
And getting crammed in with other people. So being able to be spared the commute is nice, but yeah, there are definitely some elements of the job that I miss going into the office for, and just the social interaction in general too. You're missing out on that. We do have Zoom happy hours and, just check-ins, but it's not the same as physically socializing in the office, right? Yeah. So I think that the future is going to revolve a lot more around remote work, but I don't think it's going to revolve entirely around remote work, because there are some things that are just better done in person, but there are also some things that you can absolutely do from home. And I think a lot of agencies are going to realize they could reduce their office space by a third and thereby their rent, and also just put people on teams as to who's coming into the office on certain days versus who's staying home. And it works out better for both the employee and the agency. So
Couldn't imagine having to bring, because I'm not in the industry yet, and I just couldn't, and I'm not a creative for sure, but I couldn't imagine having to brainstorm via Zoom or Google Hangouts. I'm just a more in-person type of guy.
Face-to-face. Yeah, it's definitely more difficult. We do use this virtual whiteboard software that helps us to put ideas up similarly to how we would do it in person. But, you know, it's harder to read the room. There's a lot of aspects of brainstorming that are not the same virtually. So
yeah, like body language and seeing how people react to your idea and if there's connection issues, I'm sure. You've been in, for months now you've been working at home?
Since the middle of March. So we're coming up on 3 months here.
So 3 months working at home, you kind of probably have gotten the hang of it or used to it at this point. Maybe it's not perfect system, but you've been in the Zoom realm for 3 months now. Some students that are listening have jobs lined up and they're starting their onboarding, you know, July or August via Zoom. What are your recommendations? What's your advice for students that are going to be starting online in the summer? Recent grads.
Well, I don't know. I started in person in my internship. So I guess I can reference, we've had a couple of account folks start after the lockdown started. So I would say try to be as visible to your team as possible. So whether that's joining all the happy hour invites after work or seeking out and being proactive with other things you can help with. You're not going to be able to be seen in the office, so you got to be seen over Zoom, basically, which I think is going to be extra challenging. And it's something that I don't have a complete reference for, given that I started in person. But
no, of course. And now let me rephrase my question then. Just what's your general online work from home advice? It doesn't have to just be for onboarding, but what have you found that's helpful for you?
I would say like trying to retain some elements of normalcy. So I don't necessarily work in my pajamas all day. I do specifically go out and put on work clothes so I can feel like I'm in the zone, if you will, or at work as I normally would be. Also removing distractions from your environment. So having a TV on in the background doesn't really work for me. I got to be able to be in in a quiet environment to be able to concept and come up with lines, write lines. And then also having just a dedicated space in your house for doing work, right. Having a desk, being separate from where you would sleep or where you would chill, having a spot where you can sit down and grind it out.
Amazing. Yeah, it's hard for some people to do that. But if you can find that space that separates, you know, work from leisure.
Right, exactly.
It'll be better.
Yeah, I think that's really important right now. And I don't, it's just totally unprecedented. Yep. I hate that word. That's in every single cliche spot airing right
There's
now.
There's so many cliches on TV and out there right now. Are you tired of them as well now? Like now more than ever?
Oh, yeah. These
are unprecedented times.
I think we all are, but I think some element of it was that there haven't been ads like this created before. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the strategies just settled on the same conclusions.
Yeah.
And that resulted in a lot of repetitive cliche early on COVID-19 advertising. So
definitely,
I think we're going to continue to see it get better and better as the crisis subsides in general as well. So
awesome. Okay. Any resources you mentioned, Hey Whipple, squeeze this.
Yeah.
What are the other resources? Just list them out that you either use in college or that you use today to stay up to date.
Yeah, for sure. I like this app called Fishbowl, and you need a work email to be able to join, but you can really see what's going on around the industry in Chicago. And it's not even necessarily just for creatives either. It's something like, I don't know, do you remember Yik Yak?
Yep.
Back when we were in high school? Yeah, it's kind of like that, but for professionals in the industry. And then there's also other bowls for consultants. That's really helpful for staying on top of who's running what accounts, what's going on at different agencies, that sort of thing. I also like the advertising subreddit. There's a lot
cool.
Yeah, a lot of creative directors that lurk. And if you post a link to your portfolio, you'll get a bunch of strangers happy to critique it for you.
I'm sure.
I also like Agency Spy, Adweek, AdAge to a lesser extent. I think
AdAge. You like AdWeek better than AdAge?
I prefer AdWeek to AdAge, yeah.
Okay.
I think AdAge has gotten a more general audience, but those are, and then also brand new under consideration. It's a blog about brand identity work that I like to
keep. What's that called?
Brand new.
It's cool.
They critique new brand work, basically. It's more visual than copy heavy, but something I still like to keep an eye on. But nice. I would say the single best book, whether you want to be a copywriter or an art director, to read when you're just starting out is Hey Whipple, Squeeze This. Yes. I remember reading that, finishing it in an entire night because it's hilarious, for one. But it also covers basically every single situation you'd face in the working world and how to get started concepting and what good concepts look like.
Nice.
That's my number one. Also, I think I mentioned How to Put Your Book Together and Get a Job in Advertising and the Advertising Concept Book. Those were also really helpful. And those were all books that Peter recommended and that were really awesome for me. And Hey Whipple, Squeeze This in particular was a really entertaining read. So
Nice. Well, thank you for sharing. Copywriters right now, if they're looking for jobs, I'm going to say what I think and then you can add on.
Sure.
Stay up to date on the industry. Follow what the agencies you like are doing.
Absolutely. And
especially the brands that they represent and what you agree with, what you disagree with. Keep that networking going on LinkedIn. Follow those people that are from your university, the alumni there. Reach out to them because you have something in common.
Yep.
Maybe even shoot for the stars and reach out to those higher level people that
Oh, definitely.
I mean, because they sometimes people are too intimidated to reach out to those higher level people, but they want to help. So,
yeah, no, the worst thing that's going to happen is they're not going to respond to your email.
So yeah, that's not bad at all. Go ahead, add on. That's what I think right now. But there's also like those brand camps that VCU has. There's a different online virtual programs today that you can apply to, like the COVID-19 business fellowship. But anything that you know, you recognize on your end being in the industry?
Yeah, I think this is a moment where I have to really recognize my luck and the privilege I had being able to graduate last year into a more solid job market.
Yes,
I think things are going to be tough for a while. I know the WPP has a holding company wide hiring freeze. So I'm grateful and sympathetic to everyone trying to break in right now. It's going to be hard, but I think the best thing you can do is hone your skills, and whether that's going to portfolio school to make your book even better and wait out the bad job market, or doing it on your own, going to the communications library and soaking up all the lunch shows, asking Peter or Shahar for critiques, or they were always happy to give them to me. And I'm sure they'd always be happy to help anyone else out who's just trying to get started. Just really taking this time to sharpen your tools. That's what I would recommend.
Hone them. Awesome.
Exactly.
Is it okay if we share your LinkedIn account and have people reach out to you if they are interested?
Oh, totally. And I'm happy to help anyone who's looking for critiques or looking for advice. And
thank you so much, David.
Absolutely, Gio. Glad I could make it on.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
This far, I want to thank you for listening to the entire podcast. David Hood, seriously, guys, you got to go connect with him if you're interested in copywriting or creative side of advertising. He can help you out. He knows his stuff. I worked with him throughout school, and just a great guy that knows his stuff. Shout out to Mikey Malarkey, audio technician, and Buchan John, my graphic designer for the Instagram account and all the cover art and all the logos. Just amazing work he does. I'll put his portfolio link in the description, so check out his work, hire him. He's awesome. Next episode, not sure who we're gonna have, but I'll keep you updated, and I'll do a teaser on the Instagram, so you have to follow to see who's next. Thank you again.